Welcome to Sentinels of Justice, and today we have with us Justice K.T. Thomas, sir, who is a distinguished personality, a renowned jurist, and the former judge of Supreme Court of India. Welcome, sir. Shall we begin, sir? So, India is one of the cultural diversity richest countries. And on the other hand, we have a constitution made by the philosophers all over the world, and which is a forward thinking. So how can we implement the constitution to the general without any friction, that is, in a frictionless way that does not affect the culture and the tradition of Indians?
Your question is implementation of the constitution.
Constitution without affecting the tradition and the culture of Indians.
No tradition, no culture will stand scrutiny contrary to the fundamental rights of the Indian constitution. Culture and traditions are vague terms. What is a good tradition? Something which was found very good at the time when it occurred. And second standard is, it must stand good for all time to come also. Then only it becomes a tradition to be followed. So culture, in what way you say, what is a culture? So whatever be the culture and whatever be the tradition, after the constitution came, if they are inconsistent with the fundamental rights, part 3 of the constitution, it becomes void. So only such culture and such traditions which are consistent with part 3 of the constitution will remain after the constitution came.
So moving on to the second question. On 13th September of 2017, High Court of Kerala passed an order to ban campus politics. So you have actually been on both sides, being the chairman of KSU during your college days and also being the judge of the highest court of India, that is the Supreme Court. So what is your opinion on the ban? That is,
campus politics, that subject has two aspects. You must have the full freedom to discuss all political questions, all social questions, all other relevant questions inside the campus, because that is a part of your studies. But to introduce political parties, unions inside the campus will become dangerous. That will affect not only the discipline of the campus, that will affect even the harmony among the students also. So I am one who will encourage political discussion and thinking inside the campus at the same time for banning any political parties units to function inside the campus. This is the difference. I am not in favor of any contest for any office inside the campus on the basis of political parties. That is I became a chairman of the college union while at the same time I had a very active politics outside. Probably I am the only living person in Kerala who had the occasion to have dialogue with Jawaharlal Nehru.
Yes.
I have the photo with me. So that is a time when I was in the college. But inside the college, though I was a chairman, I contested independently. There was no party at all. I won the post and we conducted several discussions on political subjects which were very acutely relevant at that time. We were more aware of political questions than the students of this time.
Sir, but don't you think the political students are tomorrow's promise? So, if they have to know something about the political parties outside
Have it outside the campus. You must know, that's what I am making a difference. I never said that you should not be aware and have the right to discuss anything on political questions inside the campus. I am only against the political parties' units function inside the campus. That is all.
Okay, sir. When a case comes to a court, it is decided by a judge based on the constitution or the evidence or IPC or whatever it is, but it is interpreted differently. So each judge has a different opinion, that is different interpretation. So don't you think the judgment is influenced by personal arbitrariness or the personal interpretations of?
The approach towards the same set of facts by two different judges will be, could be two different ways.
Yes.
That is why the famous quotation is, what is a reasonable person? Two persons on the same set of facts must have the opportunity and right to have entirely two different approaches at the same time without forfeiting the credential to be reasonable. That is the way of approach. See, my approach to a one particular question, for example, on the credibility of a witness, perhaps would be governed by various factors of my upbringing, my notion of truth, my notion of social justice, etc., etc. That is why cases are being heard by benches of more than one judge. In Supreme Court, it should have been heard by three judges, but because of the larger number of cases, they are heard by two judges, three judges, five judges, etc., but not by single judge. In the High Court also, I am of the view that every case should be heard by a bench of two judges, minimum.
Mm.
Three is the ideal, but two must be there. Single judge cases, an appeal is provided, so it is a double tier. If it is already heard by a bench of two judges, it will be good.
As a renowned jurist, your opinions are, many people are being influenced by your opinion. So many people interpret your word in different ways. So, and that interpretations may lead to controversies also. So have you ever felt that this fame and the position that you are in right now has actually restricted you from enjoying your freedom of speech, or has prevented you from speaking out your mind? Or
no, my freedom of speech is curtailed only one way. There is a code of conduct for judges, and the code, many of the rules in the regulations of the code are applicable even after the retirement. It is a self-imposed discipline. So I try to maintain a sort of restraint in giving opinion on political differences. Political
selective opinions.
To the extent possible. Unless it is a constitutional question.
In a person's life...
One more thing.
Okay, yes,
that does not mean that I have any restriction in being in politics, contesting elections, getting defeated or winning any election. But the ideal thing is not to do that. For a judge, particularly a judge who had been a judge of the Supreme Court of India.
So moving on, sir. In a person's life, there is a fair share of both success and failure to make it complete. So, success are often celebrated and failures are silenced. But these failures are the pathway to learn many life lessons. So, is there any some kind of experience in...
No. Failure is said to be the stepping stone for success,
success, yes,
isn't
sir.
It?
Yes, sir.
Therefore, failure should not deter you from doing something which you are consciously convinced of its truth. Because something which you experimented first failed shall not stop from undertaking a venture which you are confident, unbiased confidence. You must continue that. That is when, that is an area where you must remind yourself, failures are also stepping stones for success.
Yes, sir. Is there any incident in your life that
Many.
In
failures were more than success in my career.
Secret of your success.
Yeah.
In today's generation, actually, people back out. Like, this generation, people back out at the sight of failures. So, how did you tackle your failures that led you to this successful position?
See, two things will happen. The criticism is based on the factual situation will not affect me. But criticism on personal level, making attacks. If I am in politics, I have the right and opportunity to reply. But being a judge, if criticism is made against me personally, I don't get a forum or arena for giving a reply to them individually. So I try to avoid being criticized personally. Even if criticism comes, I don't reply.
Silence. There is a renowned maxim, ignorantia of law is non-excusa. That is, ignorance of law is non-excusable. So why hasn't the people, that is the government, yet made the law a compulsory education? That is, why haven't?
See, two things. You must know the law is the ideal, not practical always. All citizens are not, even today, if I am ignorant on anything, I will say that the full implications of law. Because law has become a very big jungle. The legislations are coming on every time. But some of the basic things every law student must know. And then you must also know the guidelines through which the other laws can be understood by you. For the common people to say that he must know every law, all implications of law, all judgments of the courts, including the Supreme Court, is an impractical proposition. So ignorance of justicia is a matter for defense. You cannot say, I did not know that there is a law called no murder shall take place, therefore I committed murder. The purpose is that ignorance of law shall not be used as a defense, that is all.
So, there are so many backlogs of cases. So that is inefficiency. Up to some extent, there is an inefficiency of judiciary. So, don't you think?
No. Inefficiency contributes only a very small portion of the backlog. The mechanism or the machinery has a very important part to play in backlogs. For example, backlog is where? In the Supreme Court. Why so much of backlogs are there? Because if you count the judgments pronounced by each judge per day, you can understand that there is no question of inefficiency there. 80% of the judges are very, I would say 90% of the judges are very hard working. And in the Supreme Court level, the load of work is so heavy that one cannot afford to be lazy. They do the work. It is because everyone is rushing to the Supreme Court. That may be a mark of the confidence of the Indian people in the judicial system. For every dispute, they go to the Supreme Court finality. So, if that can be curtailed by the Constitution, for example, the finality should rest with the High Court. And like American Constitution, the Supreme Court can deal only with the federal offenses, federal disputes, disputes between the states, etc., etc. Then the number of cases will fall down very much. Now, anything with any against any order, you can go to the Supreme Court. There need not even be an order. Under Article 32, you can directly go to Supreme Court for anything. Therefore, the backlog is an indication of the confidence of the people in the system. I don't think that backlog problem can be cured by appointing larger number of judges. Larger number of judges may, like the law of Parkinson, may increase the litigations also much higher. At the time when I was in the law college, the field to cover for the lawyers was very much less than what it is today. Larger number of forums have come thereafter. I have come across only when I reached the Supreme Court that there are certain forums like Company Law Board, CGAT, where the disputes are so many pending and the amount involved is skyrocketing very much high. I did not even hear about such a forum when I was even a judge of the High Court. Only when I reached the Supreme Court, now it is called CSAT. During the time of my Supreme Court period, it was called the CGAT, Customs, Excise, Gold Control Appellate Tribunal. Now Customs, Excise, Service Law, SAT, Appellate Tribunal. It will again change now because of the GST. That terminology will change, that I may call acronym. You know the word acronym?
Acronym.
The capital letters will form into a...
Forming
that is how CGAT is an acronym. So it may change. Several opportunities are there. The bench of CGAT has reached the Kerala only very recently. Till then, the Kerala lawyers also did not know about it. Company Law Board, Consumer Forum, Motor Accident Claims Tribunal. Until I became a judge of the High Court, there was no Motor Accident Claims Tribunal. We all used to go to the Civil Court for compensation. Now, Motor Accident Claims Tribunals are cramming with cases. So, backlog can be thought of only if you restrict the right to go to the court. There should be an end for your going to the court. For example, you go to the tribunal, then go to the High Court. The case must end there. Now, rent control cases you take. You go to the rent control court first. Appeal goes to the appellate court, district court. Then revision goes to the High Court. Then in the High Court, there is a what is called division bench appeal. Then you go to the Supreme Court. Why should there be so much? One tribunal and one appeal with the High Court. Stop it there. Then the backlog will be less. But persons who are prepared to go to the Supreme Court, in a way it should be welcome, in a way it should be curtailed. When the Supreme Court was formed by the constitution makers, they had in mind the American type, the Japanese type, the Chinese type, everything. But they have adopted a larger vision for a country like India, which is of multicultural, different states, unlike America where you have only one language for all. Here, different
language.
Therefore, we must, this is one of the, what I may call, penalties we have to bear in mind for a larger populous country like India.
And sir, also a court starts at 11 a.m. and also there are 2 months summer break for a court. So don't you think if we decrease the time and increase the working court hours?
No judge can be asked to reach the court. Supreme Court it is 10:30. Mm-hmm. High Court also 10:30. If you say start at 8 o'clock, what is the time for you to do the homework? See, a judge is not supposed to sit in the court alone. I have spent the largest time of my judicial work at home. I have to go through the papers. For example, 60 to 65 SLPs will come on Monday. And the second SLP day is Friday. 65 SLPs are coming. Every judge, unless he studies the papers at least to a certain extent, how much time each SLP will take. If you allow 10 minutes for allowing one SLP to be heard at the stage of admission, so there are two tiers. One, admission. If it is admitted, it becomes an appeal. At the stage of admission, if you say that no, this is not a case where a special leave can be granted, for which the lawyer will come prepared. If the judge is also not coming prepared, what will happen? You must allow him 15 to 20 minutes minimum. 20 into 60, how many minutes per day? Therefore, you can afford to give him only 2 minutes, 3 minutes. How you will succeed? You must have a homework, very thorough homework earlier, and prepare notes and make a note of that. Go there. When the lawyer will stand up, say, no, I have gone through, there is no chance. Dismissed. He would say no, and he will read page 20. He would say at page 48, there is a contrary thing against you. No, dismiss. Or allowed. That, if you allow only 3 minutes, 5 minutes per SLP, then also it will go to the evening time. That is why larger time of a good judge must be spent at home or inside, not on the open court. Therefore, if the judge is to sit from 9 o'clock, like doctors attending from 8 o'clock in the morning till 5 o'clock in the evening, there is no time for him to go through the files and prepare judgments. Judgment writing is a very, very laborious thing for every judge. He must get time for sleeping. He must get time for some exercise for him.
Sir, moving on to next question. Do you think it is true that the judiciary is to some extent influenced by politicians or politics?
98% of the case of the judges are not influenced by any politics. But 90% of the judges are influenced by the media coverage. Media has a greater influencing tendency on human beings. Every day you are reading,
newspaper.
Go on reading. Your mind will have a particular mindset to a fact. The ideal judge is the one who is not reading newspapers at all. Is it possible? There was one judge, but he is an English judge. He could afford not reading. But there are many judges who were never carried away by the media writing. Media gives their own opinion and individual opinions. Don't be carried away by them. That is a matter, that is something, a capacity which should be acquired by individual judges. There I find the difference between judges and judges. Some judges are very strong. They are not guided by any media. Even today, I don't discuss the discussions, the debates on the, because I'll hear many aspects.
Opinions.
There is a good thing to listen if there are different points of view are aired in one channel discussion. You are hearing all of them together. At the same time, some channels will focus only one side of it.
Sir, in your book, Honeybees of Solomon, you have mentioned that it was not your intention at first to come to the legal field. So, could you share with us that what led you to the...
No, that is explained in the book.
Yeah, but to the audience...
What, why I have chosen law as a course. When I was in the degree course, I was chairman of the college union.
Yes, yes, sir.
So my idea was to go for post-graduation, like secular subjects, and then to become a good teacher, or to go for any business, anything like that. But I had a political connection at that time. So many advised me that you better go for law. It will be of advantage to you in politics. It is with that view, after passing my degree, I thought of going to the law college. And after reaching the law college, then also my thinking was the less attention in the legal profession, more attention to the politics. But it did not happen on account of various factors. I happened to join the office of a senior who was a very strict disciplinarian. I mentioned that in my book.
Yes.
Therefore, I had to be in the profession. After joining the office, I found that law is a jealous mistress. And unless you allot your full-time attention to the profession will neglect you. That is why I became a serious practitioner of law.
Is there any unforgettable incident in your life?
So many.
Could you explain us one?
So many. Many of the experiences, some of the experiences I have mentioned in the book.
Yes.
Some I have deliberately avoided mentioning because it will embarrass others. I mentioned in the beginning of my book that a good author shall adopt two standards. One, don't write anything which will be embarrassing to others. Second, whatever you write must be true. So I adopted these two.
So this is our last question, sir. So what is your advice to the budding lawyers?
Budding lawyers' advice is profession is very wide. Competition shall not deter you. And hard work is the only shortcut for you to come up in the profession. And very hard-working persons have never failed. The profession of law is any profession for that purpose is such that it will not fail you. This is my advice. Be very loyal to the profession and maintain the ethical standards in the highest way possible. Don't be partisan to your colleagues while dealing with a matter as a judge. In the Supreme Court, I have delivered 13 judgments against lawyers. So, normally what should happen? I should have been very unpopular. I never allowed that it is because of my profession I must have a special favoritism to the... No, it was the other way around. I had favoritism only to the constitutional philosophy, which earned me very good encomiums at the time of my retirement, like Kapil Sibal's poem you have read, which is I have quoted in my book.
I don't remember exactly.
Kapil Sibal was the president of the Bar Association. At the time when I retired, on the day, my farewell function, he read out a poem written. Have you not read it?
Yes, I've read it, but I don't recall it right now.
That is there. That you want, somebody can take it out. That one. That is the opinion which the lawyers presented. Even Kapil Sibal, against whom I decided many cases. You can read it out.
Yes. Dear Thomas, you have been known to be a judge with a straight backbone. Same way you lacked the gentle touch that hardened criminals like so much. You set in motion, evolved a craft to deal with those involved in grafts. Occasionally, some of us did feel an overabundance of judicial zeal. The loopholes of law you plugged had many a political bug. Interpreted with judicial tact, the Prevention of Corruption Act. Many an accused you'd afts berate, make them appear before the magistrate, surrender before you, ask for bail, for some time cool your heels in jail. The high and mighty clearly saw that they were not above the law. Counsel in the midst of discourse were told the law must take its course. Prosecutions commenced without much ado. Allegations made be taken as true. The charge be framed, no appeal shall lie. None has the right to question why. For the lure of graft is unique indeed, driven by avarice and greed, be dealt with harshly in the strongest terms in response to societal concern. Your conscience was your only guide, your response to the voice is inside, your pen's command guided by God, without fear of favor, ill will or reward. You adorn the bench full of grace, can someone fill this judicial space? You leave us in the blaze of glory, others are bound to tell your story.
See, this is the wealth I got at the end of my career, because of the loyalty to law and impartiality I maintained. I asked Kapil Sibal, I decided many cases against him, very sensitive cases involving very high personages. But why you wrote such a poem on me alone? He said, he came to my house later. He said, as a lawyer, I have welcomed a defeat on a correct law instead of a victory on a wrong law.
Thank you for spending your valuable time with us, sir. It was our first interview, and we have been so honored to have you as our guest, sir.